It's small. You can talk loud.
Yeah, wait. I'm allowed.
You should take it off.
Oh, pass it around. No,
I'd rather. Hello?
Oh.
Where home is where? I don't know what to do.
So back there, we were saying how funny it would be if there wasn't a moderator to ask questions, and like we were just going to walk up to this Q&A with no plan at all, and then and we asked really quickly right before we came up, like, so what's the deal with the Q&A? Who's asking the questions? And they're like, oh, well, you're asking the questions. And so here we are. Home is where is here. Does anybody have any questions?
Yeah, if anybody has a question about anything from Thermodynamics to Bob Dylan deep cuts, you know, we can do anything. Or like, you know, we're about the band, but that's, you know, kind of lame. But no judgment. Fantastic.
How'd you all get so hot?
Oh, Florida's pretty hot. Yeah. Why, I have a question. Why are you here? Why are we here? What did we do?
You did the right things.
Yeah, we got a record produced by you.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, we made a record together. It was super fun.
Yeah, it's called The Wailer, and we have a few copies back there if you want to grab one. Then we have other stuff, too, but no pressure. You know.
Have y'all heard the record?
Cool.
Any favorite tracks?
Yeah, what are your favorite tracks? Hell yeah. Cool.
You're at the right place today.
That's what I like a lot, is that everyone I talk to always has a different favorite track. I heard somebody was like, 912 is my favorite song. I'm like, you fucking
damn
nuts.
That's dark. Hell yeah.
Does anyone else want this?
Well, fuck, what do I say?
Well, we could just talk about the whole recording process. If there's no like questions, we could just chat.
Are there any
it.
Questions about the record?
Yeah.
Now that you've heard the record?
Yeah, don't feel, we're not going to bite. You know?
Yeah.
You can ask literally anything. We don't judge. We're dumb as hell. So if you say something dumb as hell, we'll be like, that's probably really funny.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, know. Question? What's
Hello.
That?
I like the continuous animal imagery in like, I feel like all of your lyrics or most of your lyrics. There's up on the first project, birds, whaler.
Yeah, no, that's actually a really cool, oh yeah, duh. Yeah, that's actually something I think about a lot, and each time, it's not like a literal animal, I'm not thinking about that, and there's like a, usually the animal stands for something, whether it's like an idea, or somebody I know or don't know, or something like that, and it's usually a lot easier to relate or feel something for some reason when something weird happens to an animal than it does like a person. And then those things also, because I write in a way for the audience to interpret it in their own way, and in interviews and stuff, I never really give like a detailed what something is about. I'll say maybe what it is inspired by, but I don't really like the, I'd much rather hear about what other people interpret it as than just kind of spoon feed you. How everything fits like that. But I like animals a lot, and I'd feel a lot when I see them in any kind of circumstance. I'm always like, you know, we walk by people every day, but like you see a dog, you're like, oh shit, there's a dog, you know? So yeah, animals are cool.
Is it because they're inherently innocent?
Yeah, and they're natural, you know, and we're, you know, kind of, it's hard to tell what is and isn't natural now that like the environment is like adapting to plastic and shit too.
Mm-hmm.
So, and weird things like that. But like animals stay pure, you know, especially purebreds, and yeah, things like that. And also like a lot of those. Another thing, and this is like the least part of it, but a lot of those like words like whale or like bird or a dog, like they sound good and they feel good to sing. Yeah, they have like a nice little flow to them. Yeah, yeah, that was a good question. Any
very good question.
Anything else? Hello.
I know your work primarily from having done a bunch of stuff with Jeff Rosenstock, and I've always liked the way that he approaches each album with like a very specific, this is the context, this is the theme for this.
Mm-hmm.
This is your guys' first LP, is it not?
LP, that's yes, not a, not yeah. album though. Controversial, yeah.
But this is definitely
first full length.
Absolutely, for, yeah. first full length, first proper yeah. full length, yeah.
How did you approach thinking about how is it? What is the theme of this record? How do you come up with the sound? Like,
these are great questions.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, I started writing the record a little bit after Birds came out. I had a without getting too into it. I have some mental health issues, and I was going through it. And the way I cope with that is because I don't do medicine, because that usually makes it worse, is I write and make music and hang out with my friends and stuff. Or, you know, not necessarily, we jam, you know, play music and stuff. So I was going through that, and I was reading a lot of Jean Baudrillard and, like, Deleuze and Guattari and, like, Mark Fisher and things like that. And also still kind of grappling with getting out of COVID and then thrown into, like, the world as if nothing happened when, like, you know, more people were dying every day than they did on, like, 9/11 itself and stuff, and how we just kind of, you know, it's kind of like, I don't know. It was really weird. I was having a really hard time figuring out what was real and what wasn't, and so I turned to writing. And I saw things like whales, and I was just like grappling with a lot of different things, and inwardly and like outwardly and stuff. Like Birds was a very introspective kind of me, little bit record, whereas this one has that definitely, because you know emo, but it was definitely a lot like pushed out, and it helped me kind of put myself back together, and also like hanging out with my friends and writing these songs. And then especially going into the studio with Jack, because I think a lot of our relationship with the record before was, it's a really dark, fucked up record, and they're not really fun songs to us. And they're not really written to be that way either, so I guess that's on us. I'm not trying to sound like I'm complaining or anything. But being in the studio was like that cathartic moment for us, to where it was like, this is fun. We've made it like this fucked up thing fun now, you know? So, yeah, so thanks, Jack.
Hey, thank you. I would add to that, when y'all showed up, you were ready to go. You know, recording a record, you got to make a lot of decisions really fast all the time. And some people haven't really thought it all out before they get there. Or maybe some people's music doesn't really require that much, you know, decision making, but there's a lot going on this record, and there's a lot of different textures and extra instrumentation. It's not just a band playing. And so, yeah, I think it shows, because we did have fun, because it was like, oh, that cathartic moment where all this work and all this preparation and all that, and like it all kind of just explodes into the air in the studio. It was really cool. Not everybody is as prepared, so thank you.
Oh, we appreciate that.
There was a lot of thanks. There was a lot of improvised moments, like sonically, on the record as well. The end of Lily Pad, Pupils, I think was recorded. I think we did like an instrumental live take like two or three times,
mm-hmm.
And then I think by the final one we like had it. But a lot of it was also like environmental and like conditional to the studio that we. You know, haven't had the opportunity to be in a space like that before. So it was really cool to just like do that, or like you being on the other side of the like the hallway screaming while the mic is somewhere else, or stuff like that.
They went to a rage room and broke a bunch of shit. That's on the, it's only on the record for a short little bit, right?
It's like a transition.
It's a little transition piece, but yeah, breaking bottles and computers and things like that. That was crazy. That place was nuts. They didn't give us like masks or visors or anything. They just they just put us in a room, and they were like
the beer bottles
they were finishing. Yeah. It was so sick. Yeah.
Yeah, we went in there, and you know, we had booked this time briefly. That same time, that's when Jack was recording the trumpets. So that was
right.
The only thing we weren't there for. We weren't there for when the trumpets were recorded. We were there for trombone and literally everything else, but because of the, you know, timing of it or whatever, we went to the Smash Room.
It's so cool. And I didn't even know that that was like a real thing up until like maybe like a couple weeks beforehand. Yeah. Just being like, where can we break so many things?
And yeah, we walk in there and there's dudes like smoking blunt after blunt, watching American Dad with eyes like redder. And, like, you know, and they're like, so are you like our, you like our 1030? Cool. Yeah, and oh yeah.
And it was all worth it for the 10 seconds that we used the.
For sure, yeah. I enjoyed it far too much.
Yeah.
Like I got way too into it.
That and the tape reel, taking like the tape and like.
You're smashing it and like putting it into a microwave.
We
and
smashed
like
a lot
right.
of things.
Yeah, tape loops. Yeah, we did a lot of fun like analog effects and whatnot. It was very like, the whole process was super organic, which I think very much fits the vibe of the record and all that stuff. Were there any other, anybody else have any favorites that they're trying to like crack the code on, like what the sound is or what anything like that?
This is your time. I don't answer DMs.
Brandon.
I do.
Expertly.
You'll see.
Yeah, you'll see. It's a lot of rosin.
Yeah,
a
lot of rosin.
A lot of rosin.
And a lot of, my shaky leg is vibrato. So, yeah, and then that comes from, there's a long history of singing song music in American folk. You know, it's like hillbilly music. People were drunk on moonshine and, yeah, pretty much, yeah. They would just play with stuff and see what kind of noises would come out. And then, obviously, you know, like Neutral Milk Hotel and like Jordan Mason and the Horse Museum and people like that were like, put it into a more modern context, you know, outside of like the like Southern Hay Balers, which I have a old recording of, what is that song called? It's a beautiful saw of Old Miss Johnson, Turn Me Loose. This is a really good recording from like the 20s or the 30s of an example of like hillbilly music with a musical saw. And but like for a while I thought that Neutral Milk Hotel, like the thing, was a theremin, but I had a buddy very smugly explain that it was a saw. And I was like, oh cool, I can't play guitar, I really can't play piano or any of these things, I could fucking play this tool though.
It's pretty fucking cool. There's a bunch of like folk influenced kind of inclusions on the record.
For sure,
right?
Yeah.
I did the fingers and you did the bow on the mandolin.
Yeah, yeah. So yeah, Tilly would like make the chords with her fingers and stuff, and because I'm used to with the bow, I would just for the end of the transition from Skin Meadow into Lily Pad, and things like that. But folk music is incredibly important. So I think we're more influenced by folk music than like emo or punk or anything like that, and because like that stuff is in the bones of all the music we like the Harry Smith Anthology of Folk Music, I think is the most important document of music ever put, you know, at least of American music, you know. You can make arguments for classical music, but that shit is boring. So, and stuff like that. Like, we wouldn't have, like, Bob Dylan without Harry Smith's anthology, and without Dylan, you wouldn't have, like, rock and roll or anything, any kind of American, like, hip-hop, punk, us, you know, the most important. You know, so yeah, it all comes from Dylan. I'm just trying really hard to be transgender Bob Dylan. Bobby Ann Dylan.
Nice.
Anything else? Yeah, hello, in the back.
You guys have such like an interesting blend of like really tight and composed feeling elements and like really loose and organic elements. I'm really curious what like your approach to composition is. Like, how's a song even come into existence?
It's lyrics first. I write the words. The song, the lyrics inform the song. I know that's a little different than how a lot of people do it. But again, that's like that. I wanted to be a writer before I wanted to be a musician, but there's, I don't have the patience for a novel or like a book of poems or anything like that. And I like music, you know? So the words always come first. And, with the words, you know, they come about in all kinds of different ways, far too many ways, and it becomes frustrating. But the words come, and then I'll bring it to Tilly once I feel comfortable that this might be it, you know, and then she'll ask me what kind of mood, you know, vibe or anything, or then sometimes we'll just jam and accident, like, fumble into a song.
Over, like, FaceTime?
Yeah.
Or since both being in New York now, just hanging out.
Yeah.
But yeah, typically we'll like FaceTime and jam over something, at least get like the bones of a chord progression, and then do a little phone recording or like a little demo of that, and then take it to Joe and Connor, and then we like add the actual energy to it instead of just like the skeleton.
And then once we have the full, once Joe and Connor have figured out what they're doing, that's when, once I hear the drums, I can hear, me and so can Tilly, we can hear what other layers are gonna go there, like, oh, this is where, this is song is gonna, like, should have horns, or like a pedal steel, or something like that, you know? Or like, I'll just be obsessed with a song or a record, or like a style, and I want to do something like this, and I'll show it, because I don't have, I don't know theory very well, and I don't have a very, I listen to a lot of records, but I don't know, I don't have the academic understanding of the science of music, if that makes any sense. So I'll just be like, I want to make like a, like emo Flying Burrito Brothers, and then Tilly knows exactly what I want and what I'm talking about.
I should add to that too, for anybody that is not a songwriter, most bands write songs, music first, and then typically the singer's figuring out lyrics like right before they're going to go record, at least from my perspective, right? So it's really, it is really cool.
Name drop.
Yeah, I won't. written in the booth sometimes. But yeah, it is, it's really cool to think about that the lyrics are kind of setting the tone instead of just kind of like being forced into like a structure that already exists.
Because it's important for me for the, yeah, very, yes, polite conjecture. it's really important for me that the lyrics are able to stand on their own as if they were a poem or like a novel or like a screenplay, a dialogue, whatever, you know. That is like the most important part of that. And then, you know, we're basically making audiobooks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that answer your question? Is that helpful? Anything else? Hello. Yeah.
The track list early.
Yeah. Usually, when I'm writing, I know certain things will reveal themselves in the writing process. Like, oh, this is going to be the first song because I really emphasize the first line of the record and the last line of the record are the most important lyrics. So once I figure out like this is the way it has to end, that's the closer, and then the opener. Everything else gets filled in between, So it takes, you know, and they take, I mean, it took me fucking 8 or 9 years to write I Became Birds, and it's only 6 fucking songs. But The Wailer is a little bit different because dumb.
the transitions from song to song.
So the song transitions. We really, because the record is like a concept record or whatever, so fucking nerdy.
Or whatever, no big deal. You know, we just wrote this piece of art that's like, you know, consistent from the beginning to the end. Yeah. Anyway.
Because it's about being stuck in a time loop, we toiled with that a little bit on our records before, because I just like records like that just like kind of bleed in a little seamlessly. Like on our mouths, like our little, you know, bedroom EP to Birds, which is a slightly better bedroom EP. I liked the idea of them like sinking in together, but for here, the concept allowed itself for us to really explore that and like, I don't want to say milk that, but we kind of milk it. That like idea that everything is connected, and I was really inspired by the Brave Little Abacus's Just Got Back, and if you leave that record on loop, it fits perfectly back into the beginning, and that idea is something I've always wanted to do, but we never really had the means or like the understanding how to do it. And so thankfully Jack does, because you know, Grammy nominated and you know, works with cool people and stuff like that, has been around and like gave us a lot of ideas and allowed us to have the space and like the
let's be honest though, you were like, I want to do this, and I said okay, and then we did it, you know.
For sure.
It was your idea.
Yeah. That's valid, but you helped us get there, because yeah, we wanted to do it, but we really didn't know how, because the bass of the record had been recorded. So we were adding like the additional transitions and dubbing in like pedal steel and horns and all that.
And it's that tape loop, right? That does that actually like loops the whole record around?
When Tilly's on guitar and I'm playing piano and it just...
It was a portion of the tape loop.
Right.
I think it was like its own thing, taken of the... Some of the guitars. Like
reverse thing, yeah. So we did, we definitely... If you listen to the record where it will repeat, it should be a seamless like jump right back into the beginning where you wouldn't even tell where the transition is.
Yeah, the only time it doesn't sync, and we thought about this because I like vinyl, was because you know, Wailing it on digital. I think I don't listen to the record, but on supposedly on digital, it's pretty close. But on record, you know, it has to. It would be weird, right, if it just like stopped half transition and then you flip the record and then the transition picks up. Like, I don't know. That seems a little I think the Flaming Lips did something like that, right? Where they had like a record that's like six different, you know.
Sounds familiar.
You have to
put
them on at specific times.
We're not Flaming Lips level to be able to pull that shit off. But yeah. And also, you know, I know a thing or two about transitioning.
Heyo.
So true.
Was that helpful? I feel like I'm just speaking in like scrambled eggs right now.
Now you're doing. How long are we supposed to talk? Anybody know?
Fantastic.
All right. All right.
This
I don't know.
A throwaway expansion to that question. I feel like I saw in an interview that every day feels like 9/11 is quote actually the first song. Am I?
Yeah. Yeah. You're right. So I'm like with time. Really, how we perceive it is not how like time isn't linear. And this is going to be the stupidest part of this crap. No, you're okay. You're okay. But time isn't linear. And you also, memory isn't linear either. Like, you don't remember the day you were born. At some point when you were like 4 or 5 or 6, you start existing for some reason. So the record picks up when you realize you start existing, but it doesn't really begin until 9/11. You know, right. Never forget.
Very good.
Jack, compared to a lot of people you've worked with, how did you feel about this record going into it? Because I know we came in with like a lot of things that felt more like bones than like actual songs, because we came in with really inspired by like the Smile Sessions and Pet Sounds, just the Beach, like Brian Wilson in general, and that kind of like wall of sound, Phil Spector, you know, rest in peace kind of vibe. And how did you feel? How did you feel? Because I'm sure, because it felt weird to us, at least me speaking, when we heard just the tracks and
without all the extra stuff.
Yeah, and it's like, wow, this is like a really bare. We had like, you know, and we knew that, but it was still kind of scary to hear that at first.
Yeah, I felt good. Those initial bones I thought came together well, but all of our discussions ahead of time were like super ambitious. Of like, we want to, you know, come at it from these different angles. And I always really like, especially with like kind of more indie records, I guess, where it's not just going to be a bunch of like electric guitars stacked up all on each other, which is like super boring. But when it is like distorted acoustic guitar or saw or horns or like, what, you know, like all the other stuff that are keys or a slide guitar or whatever.
Like a melody of jingle jangle.
Yeah. And like all that's piano and hand percussion and all that stuff. Like those things bring so much kind of like more interesting texture to a record, to like a guitar record, you know, for lack of a better word. But I don't know. I felt good about it the whole time, and mostly because you guys were prepared, and or at least like in what you wanted to hear. Mm-hmm. Like whenever there was a question mark, somebody had an answer quickly. You know, like, oh, it's supposed to sound like this, and then we were able to just kind of figure that out. You know, so it's not always that smooth or easy, especially when you're kind of in the experimental zone, and you can easily just burn up your time. I feel like we didn't do any of that at all. We were ahead of schedule, actually. We ended up being able to like mix together.
Yeah, we did it in 9 days.
Yeah.
And the crazy part is that this was supposed to be a pop record.
I mean, it's poppy at times.
Yeah, so now we're going to make an experimental record so it comes out like a pop record.
There you go. You say we're good?
Okay.
We barely met, but They say we're good.
Fantastic. I hope, is that before we play a few songs off the record, does anyone have anything else?
Thanks for coming from Florida.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you for coming on a Sunday night when you probably have work or school tomorrow. That's awesome. Yeah, so we're going to, I don't know, feel bad if you haven't, but has anyone, because we don't come around this neck of the woods very often, this is only our second time playing California or the West Coast in general as home is where. Has anyone ever seen us live before? Cool. Tonight, hell yeah, awesome. So tonight's going to be, I'm sure you know, get a little crazy sometimes. We're going to switch gears a little bit and occupy a mode that we don't normally. We're going to try to keep it, you know, a little bit more low-key and acoustic and play some of the more... we don't really play Daytona live too much because, I mean, without Dan, you know, it's, you know, the pedal steel fucking makes that song. But we're going to try our best to, like, have, you know, just, like, share something a little intimate with y'all. And I don't know if I'm jinxing that by announcing the artistic intention of tonight, but... you know, it's a little different for us.
It's the power of suggestion.
Yeah?
Yeah. You will it, and it happens.
I mean, that's, you know, when I heard Sunbather for the first time, I was like, I want to work with this, the person who produced this record.
That's wild.
It got manifested. So thank you all for being here. Thank you, Jack, for doing this.
Thank you for having me.
You're the coolest. can't wait to record LP3 with you.
Hell yeah.
Jack.
Hell yeah.
Jack,
oh, okay. Jack. All right, I got to go. I'm taking my chair.
Did you make multiple? Oh,
yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Oh, hell yeah.
Incredibly helpful.
I don't know what that means, and I don't know where Joe is.
We only paid him for the Q&A part. So cool to see, and we say this every show, it's really cool to see a lot of queer and trans people here, you know, for what it's worth, you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, as like a, being an opening band for the last couple of years, it's sometimes a little dry. So,
Oh, wow.
Hell yeah. Yeah, they're gonna regret it after. Never again. Shill for corporate, but I like Bandcamp a lot. I've gotten into a lot of they signed my paycheck. I've gotten into a lot of bands and artists that like really affected like the way I think and make music and stuff because of like how friendly the site is and stuff. So it was like, I don't know, like a full circle moment kinda.
I found the that first Awake But Still in Bed LP like on the first week it dropped on Bandcamp. I think that was one of the first times when I actually, and I think Worry too, mm-hmm. Jeff Rosenstock record. I heard that on Bandcamp first too.
I'll never guess who produced that record.
Changed my life.
Yeah, Bandcamp's cool.
I like it way more than Spotify, if that means anything.
That was just a website. I didn't know it was a place.
Yeah, I thought
yeah.
It was.
This is so crazy. It's real.
All right, Bandcamp, I said it. Can I get my check now? Skin Meadow.
Yeah.
just realized we should have done the Q&A between tuning. I don't need to tune anything.
Oh,
so true. It'd been fun. I'd actually have banter. I have nothing. Well, we're on our first headlining tour ever. It's kind of like a supposed. Yeah, thank you. It's been a lot of fun. We're touring with Your Arms Are My Cocoon and Awake But Still In Bed. They're resting tonight, as well deserved. But I don't think The Wailer would have been made without either of those bands. Shannon in Awake But Still In Bed was like, there was a period of time, you know, during like emo or whatever, where it was like really jockey and weird and like it's like, we're kind of funny, you know, we have funny song titles, but also we're like really sad and smoke a lot of weed. And so, but like Shannon was like the first act in a really long time to feel like vital and have something to say or express. And that really inspired me and made me think that like, there's like a future in this. And then, are you ready?
Yeah.
Oh, thank God. I'll finish the rest of the story for the rest of the banter.
The info jack's inside the guitar now, so I hope it works.
Jack's where? This song is called Nursing Home Riot. It's about this and that. There's no room in the ground. Awake But Still In Bed really gave me the idea, or the something bigger than an idea. It gave me hope that this genre and this scene would make it through that bullshit, you know. I'm not gonna name any names because, you know, some of them are friends. But yeah, they know. But you know, I felt like the same way listening to Awake but Still in Bed that I felt when I heard like Captain Jazz or Rainer Maria or something for the first time. And then a few years later, as we're a band, trying to come up with these ideas of how malleable the genre really is. Because the thing about emo for me that drew me to it, because I come from like Dylan and I grew up on like Hank Williams and like Howlin' Wolf and like old boomer music, things like that. So I really like punk and things, and emo allowed itself to not only be sensitive, but allowed itself to absorb other influences from different genres and different things that usually don't fit when other people try to do it for some reason. I don't know. Maybe somebody will sometime soon. I guess that's a really cool thing about like hyperpop and things like that too now. But somebody who really made us think about how truly boundless this thing is was Your Arms Are My Cocoon, and I will talk more about that in chapter 3. The song's called Daytona 500. It's about Florida.
It's hauled on. I saw Dale Earnhardt pushing a shopping cart from the Walmart on the tracks of Daytona Speedway. Heard him say the first to lose the race always comes in second place. Ran around a fence, elk harvest your head, lamps for organs. You keep a deer shot dead in your trunk bed and lips knitted, pissing like pigeon shit. Windshields. I saw Dale Earnhardt feeding ducks by the pond. All of his spare change and below billboards went through the night. I keep checking the time to see if it's still there. Thank you.
How's a what?
It's really hard.
What page are you on?
I'm on page 14.
The part that's hard is that he doesn't even know how to read.
You made it to page 14 still?
Yeah.
He's actually on page 7. Tyler, the person we're on tour with, Your Arms Are My Cocoon, did some things that had never been done before, or if they had, they were only kind of toyed with like, you know, like Joan of Arc kind of did that, things like that, and a band called Evergreen Trio did some weird, like, tape, lo-fi, electronic things, but Tyler really opened up what this world could be and what can happen in it. And I don't think, truly sonically, the Wailer wouldn't be what it is without Your Arms Are My Cocoon. And I'm really honored that, you know, he's my friend, and so is Shannon. And it's like a full circle kind of thing, you know. And it's been something me and Tyler have been planning for years. Like, 3 years we've been talking about touring together. And I'm saying all this about someone who, unfortunately, can't be here tonight. I don't know. It's just fun. I don't know what else to say. I don't have to tune anything, so this is my burden. You know, yeah, sure. And it's like, you know, putting makeup on shit. No, I'm kidding. You know, I don't need nothing. All my favorite singers couldn't sing or whatever he said.
Another album that really broke boundaries in 2021 that I really like, and I just want to make a quick mention of is Fishmonger by Underscores. That record kind of like made me think about guitar differently. Yeah. Unrelated. I just like that record. It's pretty good.
And also Jack Shirley changed my life. Obvious reasons, but like when I heard Sunbather for the first time, I don't think I'd ever listened to a metal record other than Paranoid. So I don't know. And that like got me into way more harsher things and screamo and stuff. And now I do this, you know? So anyway, oh, I need to do things. I swear.
I think I already broke that boundary. As soon as you gave me the mic.
That's absolutely.
There was an article that was written about us that took like pull quotes from us, and for some reason I said shit in like every single thing that I said to them, apparently, and I didn't even know I cussed that much.
You're a fucking sailor.
Tell me, girl. All right.
You know. The song's called Wailing for Sport.
At all.
Jack Shirley taught me that you're supposed to tune after you put the capo on. It's a really important thing that I never thought about. If you play guitar, remember that you're supposed to tune after you put the capo on. It's crazy how important that is.
I buy all my instruments from the hardware store. We have one more song.
That tremolo was not supposed to have been on.
Whoa.
Yeah, sure.
Others bound back and forth until we make a smile. Until we make a smile.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for asking such wonderful questions and being such a kind, respectful crowd. Thank you to Bandcamp. And home is where forever.